kind of demography of people who fall in that. Now, I don't even come to this Flipkart or the Snapchat or the Paytm. Let's go back last 30 years. Whether it was the Bill Gates or Steve Jobs or Richard Branson or even Mark Zuckerberg, all of them are people when they have invented the business, started their companies, they're all from 25 years to 30, 37, 38 years, below 40. So that's basically the definition of the demography which understands technology, is innovative, can take risks, experiment. And what that technology only gives you a bigger scope of doing the business. The coverage, the scope of doing the business becomes on a global level. So we had those kind of people, and today in India, if you look at the top 15 hottest startups today, all these top 15 startup people are from 24 years to 40 years. And three of them are in the top 20 richest people in India. Leave aside the traditional, rich people like the Ambanis and the Tatas and Shivnagars and Azim Premjis. Now, of all these 15, so 13 of them belong to a certain pedigree, which is a technology pedigree. Either they have an IT or an IT pedigree. So all of them have an understanding of the technology, they're very innovative. They are rebels, yes, most of them have been rebels. I think Micromax is the oldest one. But we have somebody, this guy, this IT Mumbai guy, he just left that company, he's just 24 years old, Rahul Jadhav. Now, all of these people have an understanding of the technology, they want to leverage the technology. And there are also always need to look at is not only the shift of the employees, which is shifting from to millennials, the shift of the customer base is also shifting to the millennials. The most of the customers that they are referring to are from 24 years to 40 years. So basically the millennium entrepreneurs dealing with the millennial customers. That becomes very relevant.
So can we say that they have got a better connect with the young generation? This is number one. And second is that they are in a position to conceive an idea and then to dig deep into the idea so as to make it, to get evolved into a big business.
Absolutely.
And give a big threat to the...
Absolutely. As we spoke and as Manmohan also said, today there is the era of specialization. Whether it's online trading or online payment, finding a home on rent or buying a home online, it's all about specialization. So I think the first is they understand the technology. Second, they're able to use and leverage the technology. They're able to identify the customer base within a particular demography. And most important thing is the time to market is maybe 20 times faster today than what it was in traditional business. So I think all this shows that the future, and as I think when I was talking, by 2025, today we have 50% of the management people who are in the millennial. That is going to shift to 35, almost half of the management in the world will be from the millennial when you have workforce in 2025. So 75% of the workforce is the Gen Y. So that's the future, we cannot avoid that. So I think as far as the international people like us, we need to quickly, as Manmohan so beautifully said, we need to shape up or ship out. I think that's the only way that's left, because it's not only that they have to understand, it's also we need to be flexible and adaptable and change ourselves.
Thank you very much. As my friend, you take hosting.com and you take Oyo. So what do you feel that, what is the difference in their leadership and their entrepreneurial skills which has led them to what you call change the whole in the business plan?
Now if you ask me what are the characteristics, this world is on a transition. Okay. And very interesting. There's this figure, which came up, and that might be interesting. Radio took 38 years to get 50 million users. Internet took 15 years. Then you had iPod, it took 4 years. Facebook took 2 years to get the 50 million users. Now, The 50 million universe, 2 years, is the world of the new generation. Where things move fast, where we are actually at a threshold right now. You know, a lot has changed in the last 5-6 years. But even today, there is this very interesting, there is this interesting slide, you know, which I saw. I really love this slide. Where this person is standing, a new generation manager, and you know, the graph is like this, he's standing here, and from here on it's like this. And that's the world which is actually emerging, where the technology is going to move fast. This is the generation who are taking decision to be part of that process, where you need to take quick decision, you need to really see, look into future technologies. And if you really look at organizations which are making noise, or organizations, the most capitalized organization, the most cash-rich organization, it's all about the Apple of the world. You know, it's Apple, Facebook, and these are things that we're taking. Oh, what is the world? And, you know, Manmohan rightly said, this is the world where it's not a brick and mortar world that we can get to see in most of these organizations. They're outsourcing most of their products. Now, what the key reason is that they are the one who are constantly visualizing a future, you know, which don't exist at this point of time. You know, one of the key reasons, and there's a very interesting story, I don't know how many of you are aware of, iPod changed the world. And from iPod came in iPhone and, you know, the other transition that we're seeing. The first prototype of iPod, when was taken to Steve Jobs, you know, the whole project team went to him, he took the iPod and there was an aquarium where it was full of water. He threw it into the water. And then bubbles were coming up. He said, look, the amount of bubbles that is coming up. That meant that much number of space which is there, out there, in that particular, you know, prototype. So come when there will be no bubbles, when an extent for it. So that's the way you used to visualize the world. And, you know, that prototype was probably 1/10 the size of the Walkman which was there at that point of time.
Say that, these young guys or the generation Y or millennials, whatever we call them by any name, they have got the better visualizing ability than generation X, and they visualize the upcoming things in a much better way as compared to generation X. See, a concept of OYO rooms, a concept of what you call housing or not, all these concepts are unique in itself. I can't believe it that generation X cannot think like that, but they have visualized in a much better way.
Yeah, I think it's very difficult to say it's the same human brain. I mean, you know, is it that Gen Y has the ability to, you know, think of the future better than Gen X? But I would probably take the leap out of what Indrid is saying. You know, every generation has seen people coming in, you know, from, and typically, whether it's Bill Gates, high school dropout, whether it is Steve Jobs, college dropout, people who started from their garage and, you know, went in to do whatever they want, you know, went on to do. And they, somewhere, for their generation, they were the younger, the revolutionaries, and the people, you know, who really thought out of box.
Believe in that system of hierarchy at all, right? So, if you plug these two things, the changes with the youngsters are bringing it at the workplace, you look at the Google, because their workplace are totally designed differently. I think they love to have what we call it a very transparent and open system. And this regard for hierarchy in a way I'm seeing that. So if you see it from a multiple perspective, no hierarchies, everybody to be treated equally, and a very open and transparent system is what is driving the innovation coming from here. So the impact has been from the upbringing for the last 20 years. So it's going to rather flourish. Your
organization
hierarchy are going to
vanish. See, you are from the industry, and definitely it would be a great challenge for you to integrate both the generation X and generation Y. In case if I ask you that the three dominant qualities which this generation possess, which can rule the world in the coming year, what would be those from the industry viewpoint?
One is the innovation and the creative quotient which these people bring in, because they look it from a different perspective. So that is one I see as a big plus. Second is that they are very socially aware, right? So social networking, using it for a business advantage and for a personal network, right? Both. Using that for a personal advantage as well as business advantage. That is another quality I see. And third one is treating everybody equally. You know, they don't believe in hierarchy. I have seen that. So they believe in a very open and a transparent sharing system. Why we are very afraid of sharing that this is my personal space, you cannot share it.
Yeah,
they share everything. So I think these three qualities put them into a totally different age compared to Gen X. And that what Gen X has to change and see how they can utilize them by changing their organization culture to a different effect.
No, you are not a very, you know, good thing into that, that they are using the social media not for doing the personal interaction, but also bringing it or attaching it to the business.
That's right.
Which eventually is going to help the organization.
Agreed.
So guys, what you guys are doing on the social media is a good thing, it is not a bad thing. Okay? So, this is the industry experts which are telling to you. Okay? In Grande, like, you know, what you call, you are in consulting business. You keep on going to many organizations. What are the challenges that the organizations are facing with the generation Y guys?
I think I'll reverse the most of my clients actually want to have consultants and researchers working with them who are younger.
Yeah.
You know, so let's say we have three demographic profile of people. You know, less than 10 years, 10 to 20 years, and 20 plus years. Most of them would like to, you know, work with people who are younger. And I think there are three reasons why. First is these guys can work from anywhere under extreme odd situations. These guys can work from anywhere. I mean, you won't believe that a person can work from, let's say, home sitting in Agra, or a place like Durgapur, or a place like Thane, without actually, you know, having having an office. If they know that they will learn from it, and what they're going to give as an output is going to actually make a meaningful difference, then go that extra distance. The second thing that I find in this people is they're extremely open and willing to learn also. So that's again goes against the perception, because I had a lot of Gen Y employees working with me when even I was in the industry. No, for 13 years I was in the industry. No, and I saw that those people actually were the ones who was, I was called the movers and shakers. No, in the team. No, people who were typically from 25 to 32 years old. They were the movers and shakers. Brought in new ideas, brought in a lot of research they were doing, bring in new ideas, try different kind of models, formulas, this, that. And the third thing is what I think Manmohan also said is the informal source of intelligence that they are going to bring. So actually complements our inability to do so. Because there is so much well-networked, and not only through the Facebook and LinkedIn, because and those kind of people are either have an engineering college or an MBA college. So the networking within the engineering MBA college is also much higher than people at our kind of a generation. So whether we know or we want we need certain validation data, not a primary data, so let's say in terms of either a compensation or a job level or maybe any kind of a data. No, and when you look at, okay, guys, can you get it? Okay, I will get to that. How will you do it, sir? We'll get to that. So I think they have got that, I call the zinc, and I call it a zinc. What they need to do, and that was the question, that was the challenge you threw it, is I think they need to, whatever they bring in, I think in a lot of instances, in terms of intelligence, information, data, they need to learn to fit in into the overall structuring. I think that is something I think they need to learn. I'm sure they do it. Because at the end of the day, they know that they are going to be tomorrow's leaders. So they have to, I think, imbibe those kind of, I would say, you've got a skill or competency. No, for example, they're very good at bringing that, but it's not so good in terms of writing a report. A report writing is also an art, which you should see how to. So, learning how to write the report based on that research, the data. So I actually see a lot of potential in them, and I think if the two can combine well, it is going to be a terrific future. And this 10 years, as Kaushik said, is the year that we are going to see a lot of transition and handholding happening, 2015 to 2020.
So I'm not disagreeing. But I'm trying to add on now that we talk about millennials, we all accept a lot of attributes that come along with them. Similarly, when we talk about disruptions happening, we are all highly positive about all those happening. One attribute which I've been seeing across they have the prophecy of asking, why not? You know, if you say this is the way certain things have to be done, it's very easy for them to ask, why can't it be done in another form, right? And we are now kind of accepted that. The other thing which is really highlighted in terms of the pedigree which they come along with, and the IT knowledge they come along with. So I feel that the challenge as far as an HR manager or maybe any functional manager would have is the arrogance which they carry with them. And the perseverance they need to build organizations or probably see the tough times of business. So I'd like to look at those attributes also as far as these companies are concerned, which should be inculcated or probably driven into the community.